Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar on halal and food safety. I'm Seven Ku from ICCCM, also your host for today. Before we begin, I would like to thank the following important representative from Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture. First of all, we have Vice President of Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture, Ms. Sun Qingqing, Deputy Director of External Exchange Office, Ms. Li Li. Also, our important representative from Universitas PGRI Adi Buwana, Surabaya, Vice Rector Dr. Dwi Ratnani, Dean of Industrial Engineering Faculty of Engineering, Associate Professor Yunya Dwi Nochayani, the First Vice Dean Associate Professor Muhammad Abdul Jumali, the Second Vice Dean and the Head of Urban Planning Study Program, Mrs. Lisa, the Head of Industrial Engineering Program, Mr. the Head of Electrical Engineering Program, Mr. Akbar Sujiwa, the Head of Environmental Engineering Program, Associate Professor Dr. Ratni Ratnawali, the Head of Family Welfare Vocational Education, Mr. Agus Ridwan Misbahuddin, and I would like to thank the speaker of the day, Mr. Chen Jingchun and Associate Professor Yunya Dwi Nochayani, for bringing about this webinar with us here today. Also, thanks to all the participants from UNIPA for attending this webinar. I hope you'll find this webinar fruitful and informative in advance. Now, let's begin with the webinar for today. First of all, let's welcome Ms. Sun Qingqing, Vice President of Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture, for giving the opening speech. 下面让我们有请苏州农业局副校长 Sun Qingqing 致辞。
尊敬的印尼泗水大学副校长迪维雷特南里先生， 马来西亚国际文化交流中心总顾问，前马来西亚驻中国昆明总领事拿督肖敬平先生，各位来宾，大家下午好。Can
you hear us?
It's very clear.
Miss Okta, are you there?
Oh yeah. Oke, selamat siang para tamu terhormat, Dr. Dwi Ratnani, Wakil Ketua Universitas PGRI Adi Buwana Surabaya Indonesia, Dato' Xiao Qingping, Penasehat Umum Pusat Komunikasi Budaya Internasional Malaysia, para guru dan siswa yang terhormat.
Sangat senang hari ini dapat menghadiri acara "一带一路国家中文加职业技能培训会". 首先，我代表苏州农业职业技术学院对远在印尼泗水大学的学员们、马来西亚国际文化交流中心的组织者们表示诚挚的欢迎和感谢。Suatu
kehormatan dapat mengadakan sesi pelatihan bahasa Mandarin dan keterampilan inisiatif Sabuk dan Jalan ini bersama Anda hari ini. Pertama-tama, atas nama Institut Pertanian Politeknik Suzhou, saya ingin mengucapkan selamat datang dan terima kasih yang tulus kepada para peserta dari Universitas PGRI Adi Buwana Surabaya Indonesia dan penyelenggara Pusat Komunikasi Budaya Internasional di Malaysia. Pertama-tama, izinkan saya memperkenalkan sekolah kami secara singkat.
苏州农业职业技术学院始建于1907年，初名为苏州府管理农业学堂，至今已有100多年的历史，被誉为中国近现代园艺与园林职业教育的发祥地。学校是江苏省首批示范性高职院校，江苏省大学生首批创业教育示范校，先设有国务院扶贫办农村劳动力转移培训示范基地。 农业部苏州培训中心、苏州市职业农民培训学院 dan培训机构.
Institut Pertanian Politeknik Suzhou didirikan pada tahun 1907 sebagai sekolah tinggi pertanian pemerintah Suzhou dan memiliki sejarah lebih dari 100 tahun. Ini adalah salah satu perguruan tinggi kejuruan model tinggi pertama di Provinsi Jiangsu dan sekolah model pertama untuk pendidikan kewirausahaan bagi mahasiswa di Provinsi Jiangsu. Sekarang memiliki lembaga pelatihan seperti kantor peragaan, pelatihan transfer tenaga kerja, pedesaan, kantor pengentasan kemiskinan Dewan Negara, pusat pelatihan kementerian, pelatihan Suzhou, dan sekolah tinggi pertanian profesional Suzhou.
Sekolah di Suzhou, 香城校区和东山校区总占地面积1600余亩，共设有园艺科技学院、园林工程学院、经济管理学院、智慧农业学院、环境工程学院、食品科技学院、国际教育学院等7个二级学院，38个招生专业，各类在校生超过10000人，教职员工600余人。
Universitas sekarang memiliki kampus utama di Jalan Siyuan, kampus Yangcheng di kampus Tungshan, dengan luas lokal total lebih dari 1.600 hektar. Ada 7 perguruan tinggi menengah, termasuk Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu dan Teknologi Hortikultura, Sekolah Tinggi Teknik Landscape, Sekolah Tinggi Ekonomi dan Manajemen, Sekolah Tinggi Pertanian Cerdas, Sekolah Tinggi Teknik Lingkungan, Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu dan Teknologi Pangan, dan Sekolah Tinggi Pendidikan Internasional, dengan 38 pendaftaran jurusan, lebih dari 10.000 siswa dan lebih dari 6.000 staf pengajar.
Sekolah 组织园艺技术、园林技术专业学生赴荷兰进行专业实践教学和国际课程认证培训，与中国人民大学苏州校区中法学校开展课程培训，与美国密西根州立大学、荷兰德隆滕农业应用大学、日本横滨商科大学开展国际合作办学。
Universitas secara aktif menerapkan sekolah terbuka dan menerima sukarelawan dari Australia, Selandia Baru, dan negara lain untuk melakukan kegiatan seperti pengajaran bahasa Inggris dan pelatihan lisan untuk guru muda. Program BTEC diluncurkan dan mahasiswa teknologi hortikultura dan teknologi lanskap diorganisir untuk pergi ke Belanda untuk pengajaran praktis profesional dan pelatihan sertifikasi kursus internasional. Pelatihan kursus dilakukan dengan Sino-French School of Renmin University of China, kampus Suzhou. Kerjasama internasional dengan Michigan State University di Amerika Serikat, Drunten University of Applied Agriculture di Belanda, dan Yokohama University of Commerce di Jepang.
托农业部苏州培训中心、苏州市外办等平台，充分发挥学院地域和专业优势，积极实施开放办学，与江苏吉打邦印尼农林生态产业园建设发展有限公司签订了共建印尼苏州农学院合作协议。我们建设了印尼招生培训中心，培训吉打邦工业园入园企业员工及当地农业技术技能人才。 与刚果部黑角市政府就农业技术培训中心建设、派遣农业技术专家、学院接收留学生等合作项目达成共识，招收了刚果部籍外国留学生，建设中刚地方农业远程科教服务中心、政和中心，在刚果部开展农业科技培训。
Dalam beberapa tahun terakhir, untuk secara aktif menanggapi inisiatif Satu Sabuk Satu Jalan Nasional, Kolese telah mengandalkan Pusat Pelatihan Suzhou Kementerian Pertanian dan Kantor Urusan Luar Negeri Suzhou dan platform lainnya untuk memberikan permainan penuh ke geografis dan keunggulan profesional dan secara aktif menerapkan sekolah terbuka. Kami telah menandatangani perjanjian kerjasama dengan Jiangsu Kedah State, Indonesia, Agricultural dan Forestry Eco Industrial Park Construction and Development untuk membangun pusat pelatihan bagi pelajar Indonesia dan melatih karyawan perusahaan di kawasan industri negara Kedah dan pertanian lokal keterampilan teknis. Sebuah konsensus dicapai dengan pemerintah Kota Matia Point-Noir, Kongo, Brazzaville, tentang pembangunan pusat pelatihan teknologi pertanian, pengiriman ahli teknologi pertanian, dan penerimaan mahasiswa asing ke perguruan tinggi dengan maksud untuk merekrut mahasiswa asing dari kebangsaan Kongo, dan membangun pusat layanan pembelajaran jarak jauh pertanian lokal Zhenghe Center di China dan Kongo Brazzaville untuk mengadakan pelatihan teknologi pertanian di Kongo.
我们不急积极的引进来，也致力于让更多的学生走出去。目前学校已有100多名学生参与BTEC项目赴荷兰进行专业实践教学。 并获得国际认可的职业技能证书。学院在对外交流、人才和技术培训等方面取得了系列成绩和成果，先后被评为全国首批农业对外合作科技支撑与人才培训基地、全国高职院校国际影响力50强等荣誉称号。
Kami tidak hanya aktif dalam membawa, tetapi juga mengekspor lebih banyak siswa. Saat ini lebih dari 100 siswa telah berpartisipasi dalam program BTEC di Belanda dan menerima sertifikat keterampilan kejuruan yang diakui secara internasional untuk pelatihan praktis dan sertifikasi khusus internasional mereka. Kolase telah membuat serangkaian prestasi dalam pertukaran budaya asing, bakat dan pelatihan teknik, dan telah dianugerahi sebagai salah satu bas pertama nasional untuk kerjasama luar negeri pertanian dalam dukungan sains dan teknologi dan pelatihan bakat, dan 50 besar nasional institusi pendidikan tinggi dalam pengaruh internasional.
Kami了解到印尼泗水大学地理位置优越，文化底蕴深厚，配备了一流的教学设施，并且十分注重对学生实践能力的培养，在这一点上。 与我校的办学理念是一致的。未来，我校将进一步加大国际合作力度，与印尼泗水学院加强深度合作，拓宽我院国际交流与合作的广度和深度，特别是针对“一带一路”沿线国家学校的交流与合作。希望本次中文加职业技能培训会能为双方今后在学生培养、教师研修。 文化交流等方面的合作打下坚实基础，也衷心希望双方能够精诚合作，为推进两校友谊和文化交流，为促进职业教育更快更好发展贡献我们的一份力量。
Universitas PGRI di Adibuana Surabaya Indonesia terletak dengan baik, memiliki warisan budaya yang kaya, dilengkapi dengan fasilitas pengajaran kelas 1 dan sangat menekankan pada pengembangan keterampilan praktis siswa. Dan kami memiliki filosofi yang sama dalam hal ini. Di masa depan, universitas akan lebih memperkuat kerjasama internasional dan memperluas cakupan dan kedalaman pertukaran dan kerjasama internasional, terutama dengan sekolah-sekolah di negara-negara di sepanjang Belt and Road. Kami berharap sesi pelatihan keterampilan bahasa Mandarin dan kejuruan ini akan meletakkan dasar yang kuat untuk kerjasama masa depan dalam pelatihan siswa, pelatihan guru, dan pertukaran budaya. Dan kami sangat berharap bahwa kedua belah pihak akan bekerja sama dengan tulus untuk mempromosikan persahabatan dan pertukaran budaya antara kedua sekolah dan berkontribusi pada pengembangan pendidikan kejuruan yang lebih cepat dan lebih baik.
印尼泗水大学的领导、老师和同学们能够来中国交流，来我校交流。
Akhirnya kami dengan tulus menyambut para pemimpin, guru dan mahasiswa Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya Indonesia untuk mengunjungi China dan universitas kami.
好，谢谢大家。
Terima kasih banyak.
Thank you, Miss Kong. 谢谢孔副校长。 Next, let us welcome Dr. Dwi Ratnani, Vice Rector of Universitas PGRI Adibuana, Surabaya, to give a speech. Dr. Dwi Ratnani, please.
Thanks, Nicole. The Honorable Ms. Kong Ting Ting, Vice President of Suzhou Institute of Agriculture, China. The Honorable Dato Xiao Chenping, General Counsel of ICCCM. The Honorable Mrs. Yunia Dwi Nur Cahyani, Dean of Engineering Faculty of Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya, and the members. The Honorable all heads of department and program at Engineering Faculty of Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya, and all distinguished speaker participant of webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure to address you all in this webinar, Halal and Food Safety, supported by Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture, China, and Engineering Faculty of Universitas PGRI Adibuana, Surabaya.
尊敬的纳杜肖征兵 ICCCM 的钟顾问 Yuniana Dwi Nur Cahyani 女士 四水 PGRI Adibuana 大学工程学院院长 四水县立大学工程学院的所有部门和项目负责人 所有尊敬的VIVA 网络研讨会的参与者女士们先生们 很高兴能在这次有中国苏州农业职业技术学院和泗水县立大学工程学。My
deepest gratitude to ICCM Malaysia who continuously initiated as facilitator for this wonderful program. My biggest thanks also to Mr. Chen Chu, the speaker from Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture, China, who will deliver the topic, Suzhou's Food Culture. Assistant Professor Yunia Dwi Nur Cahyani, the speaker from Universitas PGRI Adibuana, Surabaya, who will deliver the topic, Halal and Food Safety Manufacturing in Indonesia, online market.
我深深地感谢马来西亚国际文化中心的支持。我还要感谢来自中国苏州农业职业技术学院的陈金春先生，他将以苏州的饮食文化为题发表演讲。 Yuniana Dwi Nur Cahyani 助理教授 他来自是谁的 Universitas PGRI Adibuana 将发表题为印度尼西亚在线市场的清真和食品安全制造的演讲
Ladies and gentlemen, nowadays global consumption of halal goods and services become the prospect of the halal economy, which is relevant in addressing growing concern of sustainability and climate change in halal production. Through this international webinar program, we believe that it will be very beneficial for us in gaining information about the importance of halal and food safety since nowadays, the awareness of consuming halal food become essential element for the people to see halal food as safe, hygienic, and qualified for food industry. We are indeed very delighted with this event, especially with the collaboration of our speakers today, who are from Suzhou Polytechnic of Agriculture, China, and Engineering Faculty of Universitas PGRI Adibuana, Surabaya, respectively. Also, with the can attend to our participants, lecturers, and students, we believe that this webinar has brought us to the right place and the right time so that together we can accelerate the exchange of ideas and scaling up of good practices to make positive change to our future.
女士们，先生们。 日前全球金正商品和服务的消费已成为金正经济的前景，对于解决金正生产中日益增长的可持续性和气候变化问题有关。通过这个国际网络研讨会项目，我们相信它将非常有利。 与我们国的有关清真视频和视频安全的重要性的信息，因为入侵消费清真视频的意思，已经成为人为清真视频是安全、卫生和合格的视频工业的重要因素。我们对此。 我们对这次活动感到非常高兴，感谢今天的讲师，他们分别来自中国苏州农业职业艺术学院和泗水阿迪湾大学的工。我们相信这次网络研讨会在正确的时间把我们带到。 了正确的地方，因此我们可以一起加速思想交流，为我们的未来做出积极的改变。We
welcome all members of Suzhou Polytechnic Institute of Agriculture, China, and ICCCM again to visit Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya with open arms. We would like to invite all of you to our warm and comfortable environmental site that has a vibrant ecosystem and experience of our academic and leisure activities. Distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, this sustainability of cooperation of collaboration in an absolute honor that is beyond words. Therefore, we sincerely welcome this harmony and let us continue to improve our trust and understanding through the expansion of ideas where we can combine our efforts together prominently. Finally, this webinar is a stepping stone toward our future goals, and I would like to wish everyone here great success in your future endeavors. Thank you very much.
我们展开双臂，欢迎中国苏州农业职业技术学院和 ICCCM 的所有成员再次方位是。 泗水县阿迪博安纳大学，体验我们的学术和休闲活动。尊敬的与会者、女士们、先生们，这种合作的可持续性是一种绝对的荣誉，是无法用语言表达的。因此，我们真正的欢迎这种和谐，让我们。 继续通过扩大思想来提高我们的信任和理解，在这里，我们可以一起突出的结合我们的努力。最后，这次网络研讨会是迈向我们未来目标的垫脚石，我们谨志愿在做。 给各位在未来的工作中取得巨大成功，非常感谢你们。
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Kong Tingting.
Thank you, Sisie.
Thank you, Datuk Si Chen Pin. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Di Retnani. Next, let us welcome Dr. Xu Chen Pin, General Counsel of ICCCM, for giving a speech. 下面有请马来西亚国际文化交流中心总顾问，前马来西亚驻中国。
前马来西亚驻中国昆明总领事拿督萧敬平致辞。大家下午好。首先，非常感谢苏州 农业置业技术学院和泗水 BGRI 大学的各位领导出席，很高兴我们能以线上的方式一起开展此次线上培训。在新冠肺炎发生以来，我们国际交流的形式发生了很大程度的改变，从以前面对面交流、 学习，到现在已经习以为常，通过电话、视频等形式展开交流合作。疫情阻挡了我们见面，却不能阻挡我们共同进步的决心和热忱。此次的培训由我们马来西亚国际文化交流中心、 苏州农业置业技术学院和泗水 PGRI 大学共同举办。我们马来西亚国际文化交流中心总部在马来西亚吉隆坡，在中国成都、泉州、南京等多地设立了办公室。我中心 主要从事的是政府交流、商业交流以及教育交流。教育板块是我中心目前的主要合作板块。政府交流和商业交流主要是为促进教育方面的发展。目前，我中心与全球42个国家的当地政府、教育部门、 中资企业、当地行业协会、当地高校等等有不同程度的合作。截止2021年，我中心已与世界各国的6000多所高校建立了合作关系。在中国，目前拥有600多所合作院校。 同时，在海外的中资企业是我中心的重点合作方向。我们常常讲，我们做的是教育合作，服务的是社会与企业。我们希望与更多的中国高校一起，共同培养懂中文、熟悉中国文化、会中国技术的 当地本土化人才，以中国国际化发展需求，提供强有力的人才支撑和人才保障。同时，我中心在马来西亚 和柬埔寨也致力于实体的办学。在我们开始之前，我谨代表马来西亚国际文化交流中心对各位出席领导表示诚挚的感谢。他们是苏州农业 职业技术学院副校长孔婷婷，对外交流办公室副主任丽丽，泗水PGRI大学院长 Yunia Dwi Nochayani 助理教授，第一副院长 Muhammad Abdul Jumali 助理教授，第二副院长兼城市规划研究 项目负责人 Linda Dwi Rohamdiani 女士，工业工程专业领导 M Nusron Ali 先生，电气工程专业领导 Akba Sujiwa 先生，环境工程专业领导助理教授 Remni Ratnawati 博士。 家庭福利职业教育领导 Agus Ridwan Misbahuddin 先生，以及所有的 ICCCM 团队成员、各合作方的成员，感谢你们帮助安排本次线上形式的培训，并确保其顺利进行。我们很高兴能够在今天和大家一起举办这个线上培训。 我们希望本次活动不仅能促进学生知识和专业方面的提升，还能有助于发展我们各方今后的交流与合作。所以，事不宜迟，让我们正式开始。最后，祝大家在今天的学习中收获满满。谢谢大家。
Selamat sore semuanya. Pertama, terima kasih kepada semua pimpinan Institut Pertanian Politeknik Suzhou dan Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya, Indonesia. Saya senang bahwa kami dapat melakukan pelatihan online ini bersama-sama secara virtual. Sejak merebaknya COVID-19, format pertukaran internasional kami telah banyak berubah. Dari komunikasi dan pembelajaran tatap muka di masa lalu, menjadi pertukaran dan kerjasama virtual sekarang. Meski wabah menghalangi kami untuk bertemu secara fisik, namun tidak menyurutkan tekad dan semangat kami untuk maju bersama. Pelatihan ini diselenggarakan bersama oleh Pusat Komunikasi Budaya Internasional Malaysia, Institut Pertanian Politeknik Suzhou, dan Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya, Indonesia. Pusat Komunikasi Budaya Internasional Malaysia berbasis di Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, dengan kantor di Chengdu, Quanzhou, Nanjing, dan banyak lokasi lainnya di China. Saat ini pusat tersebut bekerjasama dengan pemerintah daerah, Departemen Pendidikan, perusahaan China, Asosiasi Industri Lokal, Universitas Lokal, dan lain-lain di 42 negara di seluruh dunia dengan tingkat yang berbeda-beda. Segmen pendidikan saat ini merupakan segmen utama dari pusat kami. Kami percaya bahwa pendidikan di bidang sains dan teknologi, seni dan ilmu sosial sangat penting, karena ini adalah area yang akan mengumpulkan kami seperti webinar hari ini untuk berkembang dan maju bersama. Yang paling berarti, kepercayaan, pengertian, dan rasa hormat kita terhadap satu sama lain juga akan semakin dalam. Mulai tahun 2021, center kami telah menjalin kemitraan dengan lebih dari 6.000 universitas di seluruh dunia, dan saat ini memiliki lebih dari 600 institusi mitra di Tiongkok. Kami mendorong kerjasama pendidikan, dan kami ingin melayani masyarakat dan masyarakat. China dan Asia Tenggara adalah anggota dari inisiatif Sabuk dan Jalan. Kami berbagi sejarah persahabatan tetangga yang signifikan, yang telah memperkuat komitmen kami satu sama lain. Pusat kami telah mempromosikan konsolidasi persahabatan internasional, berjuang untuk pengembangan yang setara dari menjadi global dan menyambut harmoni. Kami percaya bahwa melalui upaya kami, kami dapat mempromosikan pertukaran pendidikan, ekonomi, dan budaya di antara negara-negara Asia Tenggara. Lebih lanjut, mempromosikan dan memperkuat hubungan persahabatan antar negara. Webinar ini sangat berarti bagi semua pihak, dan kami sangat senang mendapat kesempatan untuk mengadakan acara kolaborasi halal dan keamanan pangan di ini bersama Anda. Sebelum kita mulai, atas nama Pusat Komunikasi Budaya Internasional Malaysia, saya ingin mengucapkan terima kasih yang tulus kepada pemimpin yang hadir yang berasal dari Institut Pertanian Politeknik Suzhou, Wakil Kepala Sekolah Ms. Hong Tingting, Wakil Direktur Kantor Pertukaran Eksternal Ms. Lili, dari Universitas PGRI Adi Buwana Surabaya Indonesia, Dekan Asisten Profesor Yunia Dwi Nur Cahyani, Pembantu Dekan 1, Asisten Profesor Muhammad Abdul Jumali, Pembantu Dekan 2, dan Ketua Program Studi Perencanaan Kota, Ibu Linda Dwi Rohmadiani, Ketua Program Studi Teknik Industri, Bapak M. Nusron Ali M., Ketua Program Studi Teknik Elektro, Bapak Akbar Jiwa, Ketua Program Studi Teknik Lingkungan, Asisten Profesor Dr. Reni Ratnawati, Kepala Pendidikan Kejuruan Keluarga Sejahtera, Bapak Agus Ridwan Misbahudin, dan semua anggota tim ICCCM, anggota dari berbagai mitra, terima kasih atas upaya Anda dalam mengatur pelatihan ini dan memastikan bahwa itu berjalan dengan lancar. Kami senang dapat menyelenggarakan pelatihan online ini bersama Anda hari ini. Kami berharap acara ini tidak hanya akan mempromosikan kemajuan intelektual dan profesional siswa kami, tetapi juga membantu mengembangkan komunikasi dan kerjasama di masa depan antara pihak kami. Jadi tanpa pengundaan lebih lanjut, mari kita mulai dan akhirnya semoga hari besar Anda bermanfaat. Terima kasih semuanya.
Thank you, Dr. Xiu. Before we start the webinar, let us take a group photo together. So please turn on your camera. 开始前，让我们来拍一张大合照，请大家把摄像头打开。
Inina.
Take a group photo together now. So turn on your camera. I'll take in the count of three.
一张大合照就是截图是吧？对，我这里截图。
好。
啊，
嗯 ，one, two, three。Thank you， 谢谢大家。
来了，没有，我们也。
那我再截一张吧。I'll take another photo again. So, one, two, three. Thank you， 谢谢。
Now,
let's continue to the main part of today's webinar. Before we begin the webinar, I would like to remind the audience, you will have the opportunity to submit text questions to today's presenter by typing your questions into the chat box of your control panel. You may send in your questions at any time during the presentation. We will collect this and address them during the Q&A sessions at the end of every presentation. Thank you. To start the webinar sessions for today, I would like to briefly introduce the speaker of the afternoon, a native of Yangzhou province, graduated from Yangzhou University in 1997, majoring in culinary nutrition, lecturer with more than 20 years of teaching experience. Has long been carrying on teaching and scientific research work in food nutrition and hygiene, food quality and safety, etc. In recent years, he has published more than 10 papers, presided over 8 research projects, and at the municipal level and above, and edited 5 textbooks. He has been awarded the certificate of senior nutritionist, nutritional dietitian, and senior food inspections and management assessor. Now, let's welcome Mr. Chen Jingchun for giving the topic on Suzhou's food culture. 有请陈金春老师。
啊，麻烦设置一下允许共享屏幕，我们这边要展示一下 PPT。
好的，可以了。
可以了。
共享。
暂停吧，讲一下。对，我就简单就开始那个啥吧。好，这就暂停一下。尊敬的各位领导、老师们、同学们，下午好。首先感谢学校提供这么好的一个国际学习交流平台，其次很荣幸能承担这次文化交流的主讲任务。苏州是一座2500多年的历史文化名城，全球首个世界遗产典范城市，吴文化的发祥地，当然影视文化也不例外。下面我会将我的所见所闻，就对苏州这座城市影视文化的感受分享给大家。通过这次交流，希望朋友们喜欢上这里的美食，更喜欢上这座美丽的天堂城市。下面开始我们这次文化之旅， Let's go。 没跟你们录啊？可以。
老师，我们这边看到的影片好像不是我们看到的 PPT， 不是 presentation， 然后我们也看不到那个影片。
这个视频就是
你现在能看到什么？
没，
能看到吗？
没有，看不到。就是在那个点击共享屏幕的时候，要选一下那个影片的窗口。现在在投影的窗口是 PPT 的窗口。
稍等一下，我重新试一下。
对，然后共享的时候要点一下左下角的共享声音，那我们的参会者才能听见声音。
共享声音，对不对？能看到就行。
这个播放了，
直接在上面。
现在能看到画面吗？
不是全屏的画面。我看到上有天堂，下有杭州，苏州是有人间天堂美誉。
稍等一下。
稍等一下。
好的，没问题。
因为
这个把它关掉了。
我们看见影片了。
这个就第一张就是这个影片，对吧？
不是这个，不是的，放到这儿了。电视就
现在看到吗？
看见了，这个是是影片，对，看见了。
对，有声音吗？
有，
我们继续呢。
那我们继续。
谢谢。
这个就是宣传我们苏州的官方宣传片。他从各个角度介绍了我们苏州的这个地理位置啊、特点、它的发展以及现代化都市的特征都能看到。
Ya, berikut adalah video dari pemandangan di Suzhou tentang perkembangannya. Tadi di awal ada tentang pantainya dan beberapa produk pertaniannya.
又不卡了。
我时间我控制。 3:48。 给我个时间。
Di atas langit ada surga, di bumi ada Suhang. Suzhou dikenal sebagai surga di bumi. Jika Anda ingin mengetahui tentang Suzhou lebih dalam, kita bisa mulai dari sini.
先听声音。
Dengarkan dulu.
中好儿，与鸡斗上，后中的儿们与鸡斗上，桃李与鸡蛋喂。
Ya, ini adalah pintan dari Suzhou.
Pedagang cengwei yuyi zixian.
Suzhou hua, Hunong Ranyu.
Berikut adalah bahasa Suzhou, bahasa Wu.
Lao, Ming Zi Long, Sai Zhang Ou, Xie Shi Wang Ru, Sai Nin Sheng, Cui Feng Qi, Ha Jia Yan, Dong Zi Wen Den He Zi Mi, San Shi Yan Yu, Lai De Lin.
了解苏州，还可以了解我们苏州的古典园林、山水名胜、 古镇乡村借想理弄。
Ya, kita juga selain itu bisa mempelajari tentang pemandangan di sana, tentang taman klasik, pemandangan yang indah, negara kota kuno dan Kang di sana. Juga kita bisa mempelajari tentang kebudayaan, gambar tahun baru, sulaman, patung, pahatan, dan tenunan.
品味苏州舌尖上最甜糯的滋味。
Ya, juga rasakan di sana ada kuliner yang rasa paling manis di lidah.
这就是我们这次文化交流的主要部分。
Ini adalah satu budaya yang akan kita bahas paling penting kali ini.
这是文化交流的主要内容，大约分七个部分。第一部分，是它的历史部分；第二就是我们苏州的地理位置；第三，我们苏州饮食的不食不食的特点；第四，苏州苏帮菜的做工精致；第五部分，主要是苏州的名菜名点；第六部分。主要就是我们苏州的饮食文化。第七部分就是我们的饮食习俗。
Kemudian di bawah ini adalah isi yang akan kita bahas hari ini. Pertama, tentang Suzhou yang memiliki sejarah yang panjang. Kedua, geografis yang strategis dan kaya akan hasil alam. Ketiga, tidak makan dari waktu ke waktu, tapi faktor pada musim. Keempat, proses pembuatan kerajinan yang indah. Kelima, cemilan yang indah dan lezat. Keenam, budaya makan yang beragam. Ketujuh, kuliner yang diturunkan dari generasi ke generasi.
Suzhou 饮食文化是这样理解的，它分为内涵和外延。苏州地区人们创造的与饮食有关的一切物质和精神创造的总和，是苏州饮食文化的内涵。外延，苏州出产的食材、菜肴、点心、小吃、餐馆、饭店、饮食习俗与饮食有关的文学、艺术等等，都属于饮食文化的范畴，也是本次交流的主要内容。
Kali ini adalah semua dibuat oleh orang-orang dari daerah Suzhou tentang makanan yang terkait dengan sumber daya alam dan filosofinya.Kemudian bahan, hidangan, dan makanan ringan yang diproduksi di Suzhou, makanan ringan restoran, kebiasaan makan, seni dan hubungan dengan makanan, dan lain-lain. Semua termasuk dalam kategori budaya makan Suzhou. Juga merupakan hal yang akan diperkenalkan pada kuliah kali ini.
太湖六月是世界上最早种植水稻的地区，也就是说，距今8000到7000年前，苏州啊就已经开始人工种植水稻，就形成了饭稻耕耘的饮食传统。那我就开始吧。
Tentang cekungan Danau Taihu adalah salah satu daerah penanaman padi paling awal di dunia. Dari 8.000 hingga 7.000 tahun yang lalu, beras buatan ditanam, membentuk tradisi diet nasi sup dengan ikan.
Kita Suzhou 饮食文化的发展史大致上经历这么一个过程。春秋战国，有鲅鱼，有快，有香，有无地的汤羹。到了晋朝，取鱼杂；到了五代，有玲珑牡丹杂，有纯卤之丝。当然，下面我们会讲到这个成语的典故。到了宋朝，苏州的饮食受到北方甜味的影响。到了清朝，清杯利灶， 蔬菜流行中国十大菜式之一。到了现在，明朝是韩愈的《一雅一字》里，说到用盐33种，说明什么问题呢？说明我们苏州以前苏州菜它不是以是甜的，不是以甜为主，主要是咸的，主要是宋朝以后，改变了这种饮食的口味。到了现代，我们苏州菜就是，既传承也创新，是一个全面发展的时期。
Ya, berikut ini adalah bagan dari zaman dinasti demi dinasti di daerah Suzhou. Dari awal dinasti musim semi, musim gugur pada periode negara berperang, di sana juga ada bermacam-macam makanan sesuai dengan pada zamannya. Kemudian maju pada dinasti Qin, kemudian pada dinasti 5 dinasti, dinasti Song, dinasti Qin, mereka punya karakteristik rasa yang berbeda-beda. Kemudian sampai dinasti Ming dan hingga pada China modern yang sekarang ini. Di daerah Suzhou sudah mulai menyesuaikan rasa-rasa makanan yang ada sekarang ini.
Xiang zi, 也就是我们苏州一道特产，虾子香鱼，来自于产自在一色河。这个香子的来历，上面是一个美，下面是一个鱼，它有它的典故。这就是我国香鱼，就是干鱼的由来。
Okay, 香鱼 atau karpa di sini, terdiri dari 2 huruf, di atas ada huruf mei, lalu di bawahnya ada huruf yi, yang dibaca siang, artinya ikan yang kering. Ini merupakan makanan khas yang dengan rasa asin dan manis, harum dan lezat, makanan khas dari area Suzhou.
Suzhou 这个地区很早就开始人工养鱼，有专注曹叔公养鱼经，也就是说他养鱼的历史很悠久。苏州是东部饮食文化中心，四大饮食文化发扬地区。
Ya, Suzhou untuk sekarang ini, untuk saat itu sudah mulai untuk budidaya ikan.
Ini adalah Subang Cai.
Ya, berikut ini adalah 4 masakan terkenal di sana.
苏帮菜的特点讲究时令时鲜，讲究选料做工，讲究色香味形，讲究花色品种，这是苏州苏帮菜的特点。
Ya, untuk kelebihan dari Suzhou adalah mereka membuat cemilan-cemilan dari hasil alam mereka dan kemudian membentuk menjadi makanan-makanan yang bagus dan itu menyupakan ciri khas dari makanan di sana.
好了，我来看后面看到吗？
现在能听到声音吗？
能听到声音。
也不行，太小了。
太小了的。书房菜其实也包含在官府菜和寺院菜。官府菜就是官僚士大夫菜，影响着我们书房菜。主要就是苏州的古时候，苏州的官署比较多啊。官署呢，主要在苏州，主要就是苏州的织造府。苏州的织造府，它对菜肴的制作十分讲究啊。从它的选料，从它的这个烹饪方法，包括它的养生，都有它的道理。讲到官府菜，还有一个人物我要提到，就是叫张东官的这个人。张东官他是被这个清朝皇帝啊，带到宫里面去的，因为他是一个名厨，所以说他做苏州菜特别精致，就影响着我们的苏帮菜，是这样子的。这个视频我就不放了。另外，寺院菜和素菜也是，寺院菜和素食也是我们苏帮菜的一个构成部分。这个翻译可以翻译一下，寺院菜和与素食。
稍等一下，我先找一下苏帮菜。
老师在那个翻译他在找的同时，我想说一下，那个我们现在看到的 PPT 是蓝色的而已。
好的，我看一下视频吧。
苏州菜中的特重要区域寺院菜，对其影响颇深。
我们这个寺院可能就是因为他们在那个寺院里头也需要饮食。
老师，您视频播了吗？因为我们这边看不见视频。
做些板凳的平民，那么这个寺院里头就烹饪的稍微精致一点，逐渐就形成了一个特别的菜系——寺院菜。
鼎盛时期，番禺工厂自己遍布苏州，苏州府之源，东南四万之上，陆氏。随后虽然历经战国洗劫和时代变迁，苏州至今仍然保留一大批寺院菜和头塔。
陈老师，我们这边没有看见视频。
什么？看不到吗？
看不到，看不到视频。
看不到视频的。
没有共享到给我们，我们看到的应该还是 PPT 的背景。
哦，那我这样子，我就看第二部分，好吧？视频等一会儿，
只不过现在这个 PPT 我们也看不见。
PPT 也看不见啊？
对， PPT 只是一个蓝色的背景，上面没有字。
哦，那我然后是过来，他没共享到。稍等一下，好吧。
好的。
第二版。
不过我这个也，他不是写了已经在正在共享吗？
对，我看到了，
是这个对不对？
看到了，
第27页位置优越。
屏幕
现在应该是有一个窗口挡着 PPT 了。
这个是这个吗？位置优越是吧？
对对。
好的，我们共享。
好，共享之后，
这已经在共享了，
已经共享了吧？
对，
那我就直接就观看了。
现在不是，就是那个要点一下重新共享，然后要共享那个已经是全屏了的 PPT， 因为现在我们看的 PPT 不是全屏的。
你点新的共享，
再点击它。对的。
这样可以了吗？这样可以吗？看到吗？我在翻译，看到吗？
看到，可是没有看得很清楚啊，老师。
有没有看到我翻译？
我看到了，可是不清楚，看不清楚。
看不清楚，你放映给他们看。这样呢？
这样看清楚吗？位置优越。
位置优越。
物产丰饶，第二部分。
哦，第二部分啊，我这边有。
能看到吗？
哦，我看到了。
看到了，那我们就开始。
老师。
那我们就开始
好
吧。
好的，老师。
看到了。
看
到
了，老师。
好的，看到了，我们就开始了啊。这一部分呢，主要是讲我们的苏州地理位置部分，位置比较优越。它位于长江三角洲太湖流域。从这个图片中我们可以看到，而且苏州这个位置啊，它的特点，地理位置的特点啊，主要是气候比较湿润，四季分明，夏季炎热多雨，秋天天高云淡，冬季冰冻期不长，很适合农作物的生长，就是一句话，就是无霜期长，热量充裕，降水丰沛，且雨热同期，有利于做农作物的生产。
好的，kemudian part yang kedua kita membahas tentang lokasi yang bagus dan produk alam yang kaya. Dari sini kita bisa melihat lokasi ada di cekungan Danau Taihu di delta Sungai Yangtze. Kemudian medannya rendah dan datar. Dataran menempati 75%, ketinggian 2-10 meter. Hanya ada beberapa bukit dan area subur yang luas. Kemudian sumber air sangat kaya dengan jaringan sungai yang saling terkait dan danau yang lebih banyak di wilayah ini. Kemudian di sini juga diisi dengan transisi dari subtropis tengah dan subtropis utara, 30 derajat lintang utara sampai 31 derajat lintang utara, 120 sampai 121 derajat bujur timur. Di sini juga merupakan tempat dengan periode bebas embun beku yang lama, panas yang melimpah, curah hujan yang melimpah, dan periode hujan dan panas yang sama hingga bermanfaat untuk produksi pertanian. Halo, Sir.
一句话，一方水土养一方人。苏州优越的自然地理条件与丰富的物产是苏州饮食文化的物质基础。
Ya, dengan adanya suatu letak geografis yang sangat bagus, di situ merupakan awal dari budaya Suzhou berasal.
同学们可以看一下这个苏的由来。苏字它是一个草字头，下面是鱼，禾就是稻谷的意思，它主要就是含有这个鱼米之乡的意思。这个苏字的这个繁体字的解析。
Berikut ini adalah huruf su menurut ejaan lama, di mana huruf su ini merupakan suatu bentuk dari pohon, berasal dari pohon jagung yang banyak tumbuh di sana.
Selanjutnya, kita akan mengetahui Suzhou dan Gao Tuan.
PPT 还是看着位置优越、物产丰饶那一面吗？
还没有看到。
对对，就是你刚刚说的什么那个苏州的苏字，那个我们这边都没有看到。
没有吗？就这个，现在看到吗？我回过来。哎，怎么延迟的？杨总。现在共享对了，
对对，老师，你不要点那个全屏了，就你就在那个 PPT 这个页面这样子一页一页的走吧，这样子应该会比较顺利一点。
现在看到吗？现在看到这个？
我看到的是一方水土养一方人。
现在书的由来看到吗？
没有，
没有。
叫你退出全屏试一下。
退出全屏啊？
对。那这样子，
这样看得见吗？
你现在看到了书的由来，那个有一个应该是古文，然后一个稻米。
那我就不用全屏好吧？
那就不全屏了吧？因为全屏的话好像共享的不是很顺利，那我们就这样子的形式走吧。
好的，好的，好的，
好的，
好的。
好，谢谢老师。
好的，好的，我们来，那全屏我们这个视频看吧，不看了，不好看了。
数千年来，地理
这个视频就是讲我们苏州的高潭的发展史。
南方独到的特点。
video berikut ini adalah video tentang perkembangan Sucong。
和水生作物，地利之变，百姓火耕水弄，饭稻耕渔，稻作文化由此产生。古人在培育稻的过程中，意外发现了糯稻，成为了制作糕团的绝佳食材。放眼如今的糕团江湖，苏式糕团赫赫有名，却绝不是偶然。数千年来，
这个卡住了。稍等一下，他有点卡了。我知道他有点卡，正在备份。稍等一下，他在卡。
哎呀，mohon maaf tunggu sebentar ya, ini agak
被卡了。
agak ngadat sebentar。
好，很快。
ya, ini segera ya。
童谣一路吟唱，从正月初一一直到腊月底，苏州人遵循着季节的规律，在每个季节里给自己安排了一点新鲜甜蜜的盼头，滋味人生。至于苏州人，糕团不可或缺。
苏州的糕团呢，它的口感是糯的，而且呢是甜美的。糕团我们称为高高兴兴、团团圆圆，也传承着我们苏州几千年的农耕社会带来对节气、对时间的尊敬、对上天的敬畏。
直至今日，传承千年的糕团仍旧热情地俘获着苏州人的味蕾。每天上百种不同的糕团源源不断地供应全城，只有苏州人知道，这黏腻的糊嘴的吃食却能清晰地刻画出他们的人生使命。
从你出生一直到你离开这个世界，糯伴随了苏州人。
这是讲我们苏州的糕团啊，一年四季十二个月都有不同的品种，它的口感是甜和糯的。
Ya, video kedua ini adalah tentang makanan Suco dari musim ke musim. Jadi mereka kebanyakan adalah merupakan cemilan yang berbeda di setiap musimnya.
甜和糯就是我们苏州人骨子里的温婉。
Ya, di sini adalah merupakan kebanyakan memakai.
翻译可以翻译这一句话。所以有这个这样讲法，苏州人留客不说话，只有那小雨悄悄的下。
Ya, mereka kebanyakan orang Suco berkumpul, mereka tidak banyak untuk berbicara, tapi mereka menggunakan ikan untuk menikmati bersama-sama.
就是苏州人温婉的性格，像那糕团一样清甜。
Ya, mereka, ya mereka ada, itu merupakan kebudayaan mereka ketika mereka makan bersama-sama.
Suzhou 的糕团, 稻米加工, 可以做成各种这个, 米饭啊, 粥啊, 点心有, 糕和团, 主要就是, 比如说米做饭, 有白米饭, 红糯饭, 乌米饭。
Berikut ini adalah olahan dari beras di daerah Suzhou sana. Jadi bisa diolah menjadi nasi, bisa menjadi semacam bubur, dan macam-macam lainnya. Ini contoh makanannya.
这个乌米饭就是山上的一种叶子染成的颜色，有点黑的。
Ya, dari yang foto yang paling atas ini ada beberapa macam warna. Di sana ada warna beras hitam, ada yang warna hijau dari kacang-kacangan juga.
吃了可以长寿。
Di sini memakannya diharapkan memiliki akan memiliki umur yang panjang.
用米可以做点心的品种。 主要就是青团、酒酿小圆子、定胜糕，这也是一种糕团，有肉粽。
Ya, di sini juga dari beras bisa diolah menjadi makanan yang lain jika sudah dibuat menjadi tepung seperti bola-bola warna hijau ini, terus bisa dibikin seperti ronde atau kue, dan terakhir ini ada bacang isi daging.
用米熬粥。 我们苏州的特色小吃叫糖粥。
Ya, juga bisa dibikin menjadi bubur, nanti ditambah gula. Di sini kita bisa menyebutkan dengan 糖粥。
还有八宝粥。 太湖的水产资源十分丰富。 主要有太湖三白、白鱼、白虾、银鱼，有长江三鲜、刀鱼、河豚。 食鱼，还有七大家鱼。
Kemudian hasil laut di Suzhou juga beragam. Di sana beberapa macam ikan berwarna putih. Di sana ada udang putih, ikan putih. Terus ada rumput laut, ada ikan buntal dan sat.
植物品种也相当丰富，主要有水八仙这八种。
Terus umbi-umbian, tanaman-tanaman juga ada beragam sekali di sini.
就说莲藕、荸荠、茨菇、纯菜、茭白、鸡头米、叫芡实、水芹。
Ya, di sini ada contoh yang pertama ini ada akar bunga teratai, terus beberapa buah-buah yang lain, umbi-umbian, ada daun bawang, bawang dan sayur-mayur yang lainnya.
好，第三部分，不食不食，注重时令，就主要就是我们苏州人啊，他的饮食。 主要就是按照这个时节来的，2000多年前孔子就告诫我们不食不食，就是不是这个季节的就不要去吃。
Ya, di sini di Suzhou itu punya ada satu kata-kata ya, bahwa kalau bukan makanan pada waktunya, maka kita tidak akan memakannya.
苏州吃食多达12大类，1000多种。川菜吃调料，苏菜吃原料。王敖他曾经有过一句话：“过五日而不食，就是隔一样啥食随好，吃个五日天有福气噻。”仅仅是最普通的青菜，苏州人也能吃出四季的味道。苏州一年四季青菜不一样的。 所以呢，苏州的青菜有句话：“杭州一年四季不断笋，苏州一年四季不断青菜，不断青。”于是，苏州人的一年有了12个月的糕点时间表，有了12个月的吃鱼时间表。
365天的味蕾都在享受自然的馈赠。
主要有春天的七头一脑，就是我们的时令美食，夏天的山虾面、薄荷凉糕、西瓜鸡，秋天的鸡头米、月饼、八肺汤、桂花糕等等，冬天的抹油船鸭啊、糖醋羊肉、青鱼滑水、冬至团子等等，也就是说我们的品种相当丰富，一年四季都有不同的品种。
Ya, jadi di Suco itu karena ada empat musim, mereka membedakan makanan di setiap musimnya. Ketika musim semi, mereka makan semacam goji berry, malan, dompet gembala, yaitu kembang kol emas, kacang polong, bawang putih, otak krisan, dan lain-lain. Kemudian di musim panas, mereka memakan makanan seperti mie udang, mie dingin, ayam semangka, dan lain-lain. Kemudian di musim kemudian di musim gugur itu ada nasi kepala ayam, kepiting berbulu, chestnut goreng, gula, dan lain-lain. Musim dingin, mereka memakan induk bebek, domba, kemudian ikan, itik, dan lain-lain. Di bawah ini ada macam-macam kue khas di sana, bisa dilihat langsung bentuknya.
好，第四部分就是我们苏帮菜的特点，做工精致，讲究之道。
Ya, kita kemudian ke bab keempat.
我们就看一个。
Kemudian tentang kerajinan di sana.
苏州人做菜用心用在哪些地方呢？就是多一份火工，它会老；少一份，它会生。拿捏的恰到好处，使他的饭菜能够香飘万里。
苏州菜的火功讲究不同的菜品、不同的季节，使用不同的烹饪方式，无论哪种火功都力求精到，让食材保持原汁原味。
炸溜爆炒不失其味，出来的时候可能不需要过多的烹调，根本外物不失其情，这些东西时间长你的形状不能失掉，但是吃下来你的酥烂程度到家。
好，它的特点主要就是这几句话啊，选料比较精严，制作精致，配色和谐，清鲜多汁，成菜形态生动，原汁原味，浓而不腻，清而不淡，口味趋甜，甘鲜异常。擅长蒸炖焖烩煨，讲究火候，重于酥烂。
Ya, di sini ada satu khasnya mereka yaitu rasa hidangan yang original, kental tapi tidak berminyak, bening tapi tidak terlalu encer, rasanya cenderung manis dan segar. Di sini jenis makanannya bisa dengan dikukus atau direbus.
好，第五部分我们要展示一下我们苏州的这个宴席啊，名菜啊，点心之类。
Oke, lalu kita lanjut ke lima, bab lima tentang makanan lezat dan cemilan di daerah sana.
苏州的名宴就是宴席这一部分。我们来看一个视频。
Ya, di sini ada tentang video perjamuan di Suco.
四季分明，物产丰富，苏州人在截然不同的旖旎风光中品的是四季宴，
跟那个花连在一起， 一般春天我们称为春之宴或者春宴，它对应的是桃花，夏宴对应的是荷花，秋天呢我们对应的是桂花，冬天呢是梅花。
罗列了一下我们苏州的宴席啊，有这些品种啊，很多很多，我们就看看一下图片。比如说这个常熟的蒸菜，这个被常熟市列为非物质文化遗产，主要就是这个，就是常熟的蒸菜。
Ya, kita bisa melihat beberapa gambar di sini masakan sayur yang dipotong dengan panjang.
姑苏石锦宴，它跟锦食锦色是协调的。
Ya, di berikut ini adalah cara untuk meletakkan di meja saat perjamuan.
江南运河宴，我们苏州在这个京杭大运河边，所以说有了这个水，很有水乡特色，所以我们做了一些做了一些尝试，就是发明了这个叫运河宴。
Nah, kita juga ada satu pemandangan di sana namanya Yinghe, yaitu di daerah selatan dan sajiannya disesuaikan dengan pemandangan di sana.
这是太湖船宴，就船宴就是在船上吃的。当然随着这个现在环保意识的加强，这个已经船上已经到了岸上了，那但是它的特色还在，主要就是鱼鲜部分。
Kemudian di sini ada pelabuhan Taiwu dari Danau Taiwu di sini sudah lama tapi masih budayanya masih terus ada。
如今苏州太湖边的渔船人家依旧传唱着这些歌谣，传递着人们对自然恩赐最初的欣喜。
顾名思义，就是讲蔬菜蔬地，蔬菜生于蔬浪向，就是蔬菜的对浪的区域是蔬酿山一点的江浪菜。那么搿个菜的不是一定的精致，而是讲是讲一个口味，当然菜锅里的菜的口味是飞扬。
苏州因为有了水才有了船，形成了以水产为中心的独特的菜肴体系。船菜对苏州菜的特色形成了深远的影响。船舶摇曳，水往深处，滋
有我们太仓市的苏州的一个地级市太仓市的全羊宴，全部是羊肉做的。
Kemudian ada juga hidangan yang semua terbuat dari daging kambing.
有吴江垂虹素宴，它都是素的，啊，都是素，以植物啊，啊，也是素菜来做成的。
Lalu kemudian ada lima hidangan ini semua terbuat dari sayur mayur atau untuk vegetarian.
齐顺兴家宴。这是一个西顺兴，是一户大户人家，做出来的菜也相当精致，所以说他的家宴也非常有特色。
Kemudian ini juga masakan khas di sana, masakan rumah yang merupakan masakan khas di daerah sana。
有郑和宴，就是我们这个郑成功啊下西洋的时候，那他这个按照这个故事啊，他创作出来的就叫郑和宴。
Lalu makanan ini disebut dengan Zhenghe Ye, itu merupakan suatu kisah, suatu histori yang kemudian digambarkan dalam hidangan.
其他还有四季宴、寒食宴、端午宴、重阳宴、冬至宴、谢宴、吴王宴、婚庆宴等等等等。好，下面我们，这个可以不翻译。下面可以我们了解一下这个苏州的名菜。
Ya, kemudian kita bisa mempelajari lagi untuk
苏州的这个我们苏州的招牌就是松鼠桂鱼，形状像松鼠，口感酸甜，松鹤楼的上品菜肴。
Ini untuk olahan ikan yang dibentuk dengan bentuk seperti ini, dengan rasa yang asam dan manis.
有碧螺虾仁，碧螺是茶叶之意，是茶叶的意思。用茶叶跟虾仁一起做菜，口感鲜甜。
Lalu ada juga olahan dari udang yang dimasak bersama dengan daun teh.
有常熟的叫花鸡，就是用荷叶包裹加工好的鸡肉，然后用泥巴包裹上火烤制。
Terus kemudian di sini ada ayam yang dimasak dengan dibungkus dengan daun teratai.
有巴肺汤，这个鲅鱼是我们苏州的一个地方特产。那它的肺，我们用它的肺来做这个汤，那口感相当美妙，滑嫩。
Terus kemudian di sini ada sup ikan, itu merupakan isi dari dalam ikan yang dibuat menjadi sup.
还有天下第一菜，叫虾仁锅巴，最平常的菜，做出了不一样的感觉。这个是在苏州的老字号菜馆中，锅巴菜被称为天下第一菜，最接地气的食材，原和会配上顶级的菜名，来源于皇帝下江南的一次奇遇故事。 原料虽然简单，烹饪方式却凝集了苏帮菜的精髓。松脆的锅巴，滚烫的卤汁，精准的火候和时间点把握，造就了一次奇妙的接触。
因为这个菜呢，在所有的菜中间，它的声响最大，啊，而且它还有一个病名，平地一声雷。那这个菜的意境很好，那口感也不错，所以说叫天下第一菜。
Di sini ada makanan nomor satu di sana dengan rasa yang lezat dan rasa yang beda dari yang lainnya.
下面我们来看看我们苏州的名点名小吃。
Lalu di bawah ini kita akan lihat makanan snack di sana.
苏式的月饼。
Di sini ada kue bulan.
苏州的船点。
Terus dimsum.
它的特色就是以前都在船上做的，它的特色就是造型比较笔直。 艺术造型相当美妙。
Ya, di sana yang menjadi khasnya adalah bentuknya yang unik dan merupakan seni yang bagus.
当然它的口感也是不错的。
Dan tentunya rasanya pasti juga sangat enak.
也就是这个苏州的海棠糕也有百年历史了。
Terus kemudian ini juga kue yang terdiri dari makanan laut yang merupakan makanan yang memiliki sejarah yang panjang.
再介绍一种叫蟹黄汤包，是用大闸蟹的这个蟹黄做成的这个点心。
Ya, kemudian ada semacam bakpao di sini yang juga memakai saus. Juga merupakan makanan snack khas di sana.
在我们这边的吃法很讲究，通常说叫轻轻提，慢慢移，先开窗，后吸汤。
Oke, lalu di sini ada juga cara memakannya yang khas, yaitu diambil dengan sumpit perlahan-lahan, kemudian dimakan secara hati-hati, lalu baru dirasakan satu saus yang ada di dalamnya.
这说明了我苏州人饮食的精细雅致。 这个叫拓黄油面，这个拓啊，是苏州的方言，它是只有的意思，独有的意思，都是蟹黄做的，这个价格也不菲。
terus di sini ada juga mie yang di atasnya ditambahkan dengan kuning telur.
是中华美食的。 最高境界，当然就是很高的夸奖了。
Ya, dan di sini tentu banyak sekali peminatnya.
好，第六部分我们来谈一下苏州的饮食文化，它的这个一些主要的内容吧。一个是我们苏州的食品体系庞大，经过多年的发展，我们苏州的食品有12个大类，1200多个品种。 12个大类有6个帮食，6种特色。
Kemudian yang keenam kita akan membahas tentang 6 macam kekhasan dari Suzhou.
有苏式蜜饯，苏式糖果。
Ini adalah permen atau kembang gula.
有苏式炒货，
terus juga ada buah kering，
苏式酱菜，
terus macam awetan dan saus，
苏式调味品，
ini adalah bumbu-bumbu dapur，
苏州的虾子酱油相当有名气， 苏州的桂花是我们苏州市的市花，
lalu ada juga semacam saus。 Saus tiram di sana yang merupakan makanan bumbu utama di sana.
用桂花制作的糕团点心，品种相当之多。 苏州的老字号。 这是我们苏州的老字号，有百年历史的。
Ya, di situ adalah satu lukisan Suzhou yang memiliki sejarah ratusan tahun.
名菜、名碟等等，都几乎都来自于这里。
Ya, beberapa gambar restoran di sini juga merupakan tempat awal-awal penjualan makanan khas di sana.
苏州的这个饮食环境、食材、工具、吃法的讲究，这里面我们找一个图片，举一个例子，比如说我们吃蟹的时候，我们要赏菊花，叫慈螯赏菊。
terus di sana ada dua lukisan ini, dua gambar ini adalah contoh ketika kondisi tokoan di sana cukup ramai.
我们苏州人还有这样的一个一种吃蟹的工具，很有特色的，叫蟹八件，这个是吴地人美食文化的一种情趣。过去苏州大户人家吃螃蟹的时候，他必备的。
kemudian di sini ada bermacam-macam alat untuk memakan 8 kepiting ya, alat pemakan kepiting khusus untuk orang Suzhou. Mereka punya cara khasnya sendiri.
说明苏州人以前吃法相当奢侈，而且很讲究。
Ya, mereka sangat hati-hati dan sangat mementingkan cara memakan dengan seperti ini.
有很多的书籍。 都讲到了我们苏州的饮食，这里面有青家路、铜桥、蚁族路、福生六记等等等等。
Lalu di bawah ini ada bermacam-macam buku yang menjelaskan tentang bermacam-macam makanan di Suzhou.
Suzhou 的饮食业啊，从我们这个姑苏繁华图，几乎可以全部看到它当时的影子。饮食业很发达，叫姑苏繁华图。
Lalu di sini ada lukisan gambaran zaman saat itu betapa ramainya pertokoan dan restoran di sana.
Ada juga cerita cerita yang menggambarkan Suzhou makanan dan kultur ini. Contohnya, "自娱专注, 自娱专注, 纯如自私, 渔舟饭里, 釜里压根, 雨菜小碗, 中馈云凉, 等等等等. 这是一些成语典故.
Lalu di bawah ini ada beberapa adalah peribahasa di daerah Suzhou.
This 他为了思念家乡的鲈鱼以及纯菜，官都不做了，所以说这个纯鲁之思啊，这个成语啊，它就流传下来了。
Dijelaskan di sini tentang peribahasa yang pertama adalah ketika seorang berusaha memancing dan mencari ikan.
这个卡住了，稍微卡了一下，一拖它就，稍微等一下。
Ditunggu sebentar ya, mohon ditunggu sebentar.
第七部分，也就是最后一部分，就是我们苏州的饮食习俗部分。
Kemudian ada di bab 7, yaitu bab yang terakhir, kita membahas tentang kebiasaan atau tradisi makan yang turun-temurun.
比如说正月初一我们要吃春饼圆子，正月十五元宵节我们要吃汤圆，二月初二我们要吃蒸腰糕，就油煎年糕，清明节要吃青团，四月十四嘎神仙，我们要尝各种小吃，立夏我们要吃鲜果，新鲜的水果，我们要吃这个时蔬素菜，比如说蚕豆等等。五月初五，我们要吃这个端午节要吃粽子。
Di sini ada contoh misal di pada bulan satu tanggal satu atau di tahun baru itu orang-orang di sana memakan makanan khas mereka yaitu pangsit. Kemudian di tanggal 15 Agustus atau festival musim gugur, mereka biasanya memakan kue bulan. Lalu pada musim panas atau musim-musim atau di bulan-bulan lima, biasanya mereka memakan buah-buahan dan lebih banyak mengkonsumsi sayur. Kemudian pada tradisi perahu naga, mereka banyak mengkonsumsi kue bacang.
七月叫七巧节，我们要吃那个七巧果巧果。八月十五中秋节要吃月饼。九月九日重阳节，我们要吃重阳糕。十月要吃螃蟹。十一月冬至节，我们要吃冬至团和冬酿酒。
这个是
七月、八月、九月、十月、十一月。就是我们吃，每月我们都有不同的这个食用的这个饮食习俗吧。
Kemudian di bulan Oktober itu biasanya mereka makan kepiting danau dan makan makanan seperti udang dan lain-lain. Kemudian di November atau titik balik matahari musim dingin, mereka memakan seperti kuah ronde.
好了，谢谢我们的翻译。一句话。 无论春夏秋冬，欢迎到苏浙来做客，谢谢大家。
Sekian dari saya, terima kasih banyak.
Oke，我们这次交流，我这部分就结束了。感谢。
Sekian presentasi dari saya, terima kasih banyak semuanya.
那我这边就退出了。哎，谢谢陈老师。嗯。
现在的话会有一个简单的一个问答环节，我们会看一下我们印尼的同学有没有问题。嗯。那，Thank you, Mr. Chen. Now we have come to the Q&A sessions. So if any students or any participants has any questions, feel free to voice out your questions in the chat box so we can ask Mr. Chen now. Miss Octa, 那陈老师，我们稍等一会儿，看一下我们同学们有没有问题。
我这样，就这样，好吧。
No questions. We end the Q&A session here. Thank you, Mr. Chen, again for the knowledgeable webinar. 所以，谢谢陈老师。哦，谢谢，谢谢。
好的，那就到这里，拜拜。好的，拜拜，辛苦了。哦，没有，好。好。我直接退出了，不退吧，我就这样。不用，就这样，我来。先休息一下。他们不能，下一次。对对，还有我来，我要去上一次。蔡小明，我也不要参与。对对。他们两家讲，你一个。对对，我主要是在这看，如果有什么特殊情况，就打电话给杨老师。哦。我太多了，写不完。
Now let's welcome to our second speaker for today, Associate Professor Ilnya Dwi Nocharyani, for giving the topic on halal and food safety manufacturing in Indonesia online. Welcome, Associate Professor Ilnya.
Thank you, Seven.
Welcome. Yeah, you may share your screen now.
Okay. Seven, I cannot start screen share. Do you mind if changed me to co-host, please?
I think you can share now because just now I was sharing. Yeah, I just
stopped. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, is my screen share already available there?
Yeah. But it's not in the presenter mode.
All right. I'll change it. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's great now.
Okay. Thank you, Seven.
Welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to each and every one of you for being today at this wonderful webinar. I'd like to say thank you before I started, I would like to express my appreciation to the ICCM and Department of Public and Relations and Cooperation Universitas PGRI Adi Buana Surabaya, who generously helped us to make this seminar come true. And to Mr. Marian Subandowo, Rektor Universitas Pegeria di Buana Surabaya, as Vice Rektor, Datuk Xie Qianpin, General Counsel of ICCM and other ICCM teams, and also Ms. Kong Tingting, the Vice President of Suzhou Polytechnic Agriculture China. We could not have done it without you all. Let me introduce myself. My name is Yunia Dwinur Cahyani. I'm the lecturer of Industrial Engineering Department in Adibuana University. I have spent more than a decade higher education with focus on sustainable product development leads since 2004. I have worked as a lecturer in Universitas PGRI Adibuana Surabaya, Department of Industrial Engineering. Academically, I'm a profilic researcher, having authorized multiple books and contributed to numerous international conferences and journals. Since 2004, we have participated in many variety of community services, activities relating to product development and also food development. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get started to our seminar. Based on the topic given, today we'd like to looking for the agenda. We have agenda first, introduction of engineering faculty of Adibuana Surabaya. Second, halal supply chain, halal online business in Indonesia, and also halal and food safety in Indonesia. In this picture, I'd like to tell you this is Indonesia, of course, and we are stated in here, and it's East Java province in Surabaya city. So as Suzhou, we also have many cultural like Remo dancing, and this is the Adibuana flower cart. We have also participated in flower cart in Surabaya city. So engineering faculty, we have five departments: electrical engineering, industrial engineering, environmental engineering, urban planning, and family welfare education. Integration between family welfare vocational education study with concentration on culinary art, fashion style, and cosmetology, together with knowledge of halal logistics from industrial engineering department, food safety from environmental engineering, halal tourism industry mapping and planning at the regional and city planning department. Moreover, all electrical engineering in halal electronic food grade material also. To see an overview of the Adibuana Engineering Faculty Surabaya allow us to play profile from Adibuana University. Stops here. Excuse me, I have to play the YouTube. Kok nggak bisa ya dia? Excuse me, can you hear the voice of the video?
It's not playing yet, right?
Okay.
The video is not playing.
Okay.
We cannot hear it clearly.
You cannot see the video.
Yeah, we can see the video, but we cannot hear the video clearly. Like,
oh, okay. You cannot hear the video voice.
Professor Yunia, did you like click the share sound when you click share screen?
Yes, I try to find the button.
So the,
okay,
the
share sound button,
the share sound button is at the bottom left when you choose which screen you want to share.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, just keep the video. Let's continue to my presentation, all right? I will show you this video in the last presentation. Is it okay, Seven? Okay. Thank you. Let me continue my presentation. Okay. Is my presentation already available there? Okay. Now we continue with halal supply chain. Why halal? Next, we will discuss about why halal is important. What are the halal products that we should know? How is the halal supply chain industry that we should conduct in Indonesia as well? Halal product and certification. Here we have picture like this. This is a traditional market of meat product in Surabaya. So as you can see, this kind of meat, this is the cow meat here. You can see that this meat cannot labeled yet. So we cannot see which one is cow meat, which one is other meat. But as a Muslim majority country, also we are in Surabaya, usually sell the cow meat here in the traditional market. Below here, this is the fish meat. This is the fresh fish meat, the fresh fish market in Surabaya also. And in the bottom is the vegetable fresh market also in Surabaya. So why halal? Halal is contains not only food. Halal, we can see this is the food halal, fashion halal, cosmetical halal, and also electrical halal, medicine halal, financing halal, and also tourism halal. So why halal product is important? Since Indonesia established halal certification, the formation of LPPOM MUI was based on mandate of a government at Indonesian Ulama Council, played active role alleviating cases in large Indonesia in 1988. LPPOM MUI was established in January 6, 1989 to carry out halal inspection and certification as well. Halal certification issued by Halal Product Assurance Organizations. Since the law of number 33/2014 concerning halal product assurance stipulated by the President of Republic of Indonesia, then the authority to issue halal certificate in Indonesia being delegated to the halal product assurance, here in after abbreviated as BPJH, which is established by the government to administrate halal product guarantees. So the market review. Halal is more and more complete range of product offerings for market change. It's also the phenomena applying not only food, personal hygiene, healthcare products, toiletries, cosmetics, and all appearing halal option. Once halal is understood as lifestyle choices, the range of options increase exponentially. So the second market review, we can see that ASEAN countries are one of the world leading suppliers and also important of halal certified product all over the world. These case countries compete in the international front, including Indonesia as well. Then has been substantial trading halal product among them. So for example, Indonesia is biggest buyer of Malaysian halal food from ingredients and other item. Change that huge and untapped market also. Around 80% of halal food industry in the hand of the Muslim. The Brazilians also being a big halal producer for decades, even the Brazilians mostly not Muslim. 3/4 of chicken exported by France are halal. Even the France as well is not a majority in Muslim. The third review, the players from every sector in industry, from huge multinational down to small enterprises, are looking to capture their share of this growing market, like Nestle, Tesco, Colgate, etc. And more supermarket and hypermarket adding halal self to attract ethnic Muslim population in non-Muslim countries. And I believe China has a halal label too. And halal product, the first, we can see that halal products include both food and non-food item. Halal products is not only meat, poultry, but also other food items such as confectionery. Like here, you can see this is gudeg in convention, cannot frozen food. Like here, this is a sambal gledek. This is a traditional sambal from Indonesia. It's very, very spicy. Dairy produce, bakery, organic food, herbal product, beverages, and others. Halal products also includes non-food such as cosmetics, toiletries. Like here, this is cosmetic, beauty products, pharmaceutical, leather, perfume, and etc. And we can see that global food supply chain disruption presents strong opportunities for Indonesian small, medium enterprises exports. Like here, that Indonesia as top food sector for Indonesian top export, is number four is product for animal origin, like cow, poultry, and others, meat products here. It consists almost $2,000 billion food and beverage imported by YC countries, but Indonesia export to them. So, why food? Why food? Well, food is basic, you know, and every human concern. Everyone eat, right? So everyone need food. But in Indonesia, as a Muslim, food are not being separated with religion. Food and religion for the ways are perhaps and their most complex that become involved in religion, as Anderson said. It is central to religion as a symbol, as a subject of prayer, as a marker of sharing and unsharing, as communion. So in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah 24, humans should perform and should remain what he is eating. But also not just halal, but food is also must be safety. So food safety common understanding concept is the assurance that food will not cause harm to the consumer when it's prepared or be eaten according to its intended use. So in Indonesia, we have a regulation based on halal and safety food also that a lot of items in regulation in Indonesia has been prepared to save Indonesian market and other market around the world. So Al-Quran Surah Al-Baqarah is also said that humans should eat the halalan product and toyib. Toyib is the good eating materials or safe eating materials. So what is the opposite of halal is haram. What is the haram food? It's najis, it's memabukkan. So I can give you the examples of haram food. Haram food made of carcasses, carcasses, all the animals that died without Shari slaughter, or Indonesia said bangkai. It's not the result of hunting. The haram food made of anything, any food made of blood. There's blood that flows and radiated, so it's keep and it's maybe frozen it, and it's canned and it's being another food. Pork, that is provident that pork includes that all part of its pork body, including the fat and other small materials of the pork. So sometimes the supplier said that we are not using pork material, but they are using the oil material of pork. They are using part of material of pork. So that still included the haram food. So it's not allowed to Muslim to eat. Alcohol. Alcohol in the hadith narrated by the Muslim that everything that intoxicated is haram. And alcohol is haram also. So then, what is the purpose of this halal and haram item? It's Allah said that human should be allowed to what everything that Quran and Hadith is already written there. So halal is the branch of Islamic law that governs area of life, including food consumption from Quran and Sunnah. So this is other law that published by Indonesian government. So every wood, every cosmetic that consumed by Indonesian market must be certificated by halal. Like Mr. Chen Jinchun from Suzhou culture, it seems that Suzhou and Surabaya has similarity in food culture, right, Mr. Chen Jinchun? Perhaps you can stop, come by to Surabaya and come to Adibuana University. So brothers and sisters from Suzhou University can eat curry. Curry is like ingredients from based on coconut milk. It seems that in Suzhou they has already things like curry. I see previous and food based or contained with banana leaf wrapping. It seems that Suzhou is already have things like this, but in Indonesia we call it pepes. Many kind of pepes. So what kind of pepes? I don't explain it here, so you can come by to Surabaya. So I can give you free pepes from me. The other food is jajan pasar. Jajan pasar is made of ketan rice, or previously shows that Suzhou have black rice, brown rice, and other items. Also in Surabaya, we have such kind of rice. And the jajan pasar is the food that made of any kind of rice that you have shown before. Surabaya has already also have satay or sate. Here in Surabaya we can see sate klopo, sate ayam, sate sapi, sate komo, and other. What kind of food is that? I cannot tell you because they are so delicious. So you have to come here and join us so we can give you free satay. This is the kind of salad. It's called Semanggi Surabaya. And this Semanggi Surabaya made from, it's a kind of, things, gulma in unwanted plant in the field. Rice. So, but it's delicious, and you can see this made of not peanut sauce. It's come from sweet potato sauce. It's very delicious. So, rawon Surabaya. Rawon Surabaya is based on meat, and this is combined with black ingredients. Soup, so this is very delicious. Even it's black, even some people don't like black food, but we can show you this is very, very delicious. So in dessert we have jenang grandul, serabi, and other kind of food. It seems that in Suzhou you have presented visually Suzhou food and Surabaya food have similarity. So we can be sisters city perhaps. Halal online business in Indonesia. So from 2020-2024, internet food delivery in Indonesia has anticipated rise into 11.5% yearly. In 2018, food sales made up to 24.85% of all e-commerce sales, making it as the biggest category. Consumer benefit from increased variety and convenience is also provide works and income for merchants and deliverers. However, the third party deliver services present a distinct food concern by separating between consumers and sellers. Based on safety standard, pre-market certification and post-market monitoring are the responsibility of Ministry of Health and local governments. Complication in registration procedure deter smaller firms from formalizing before joining the market, while insufficient government capability and cooperation deter efficient post-market oversight. This has actual ramifications since half of unregistered food in Indonesia is dangerous to eat. So that's the fact. But don't worry, we are going to clean it up. City and district government should lower market entry barriers of family businesses to improve food safety. The pre-market certification procedure should be straightforward, educate merchants and food safety regulation, and allow to for issue that tracking. So in Indonesia, we have a lot of e-commerce that grown up. We call it unicorn business, like Shopeefood, GoFood, GrabFood, also food that sold from social media like Instagram and others, internet online sellers. So the final recommendations to exclude processed from food delivery from plastic, it must be reduced until the rules are revised to reflect the food industry specific demands and the many plastic bag kind and features. The use of biodegradable polymers should be continued, and the government should encourage the development of durable plastic alternative. So halal food and online business in Indonesia, like here, online business in Indonesia developed rapidly during the pandemic COVID-19. It impacts halal market in small medium enterprises, so people cannot go everywhere, it's been locked down, so they shop from online market, including food and raw materials also. So the government must have strategic planning for halal market in small medium enterprises to be recovered after the pandemic COVID-19. But this pandemic gave also opportunities for Indonesia small medium enterprises by using the online business niche market. So why online food business is in Indonesia grown up rapidly? Indonesia have internet user about 132.7 million people. Indonesia have social media user about 130 million people, and mobile phone user about more than 400 million around the world. Okay, a social mobile user have and 20 million account. So among the other SofiFood, GoFood, GrabFood, but GoFood is the number one online food delivery service in Indonesia by controlling 80% the online food delivery market share for four times larger than similar market for provider. So based on Kusnandar that stated that with this percentage, Indonesia is the country is largest Muslim population in the world. The size Muslim population must be with awareness consumption of halal food, also called halal awareness. Awareness consuming halal food in indirectly affect the development of halal industry. As you can see here, we have some pictures, Seven and friends from Zuzu. We have a Joglo restaurant here, and we have Zangrandi. This is the oldest ice cream store in Surabaya. Both restaurant or street vendor, they are using online food business. So this kind of business is very rapidly developed in Surabaya, moreover in Indonesia. So what is the food safety issues in food delivery? We have three kind of issues: food production and sales, food delivery, and food consumption. In food production and sales, food safety during food production falls under the responsibility of merchants. However, many merchants offering food delivery are informal or micro enterprises, such as street vendors and household enterprises. They tend to lack of knowledge and apply poor food handling practices. Street vendors may not even have access to proper facilities and infrastructures such as basic sanitation, clean water, cold storage, based on any electricity. Unfortunately, online food delivery make it hard for consumer to avoid food safety risk. As you see that online market just show you the picture, and even the picture is a beautiful picture that present in online food, but the process we cannot see, we cannot able to see, the market cannot able to see how hygiene the process behind that picture. Customer lack of information need to accurately access food safety risk because the information is not provided on the platform and they cannot inspect the food preparation directly. Unlike the consumer who picks the food themselves or dines in restaurant, consumer who order online are unable to see physically the place that the food is being prepared. So due to the COVID-19 pandemic has created additional concern, added additional variables. Although 70% of consumers reported that they care more about food safety during the pandemic, but they cannot inspect whether food merchants follow recommended health protocol or not. While the WHO said they consider highly unlikely the people can contract with COVID-19 from food or food packaging, they offer several recommendations for food worker to reduce the risk, such as sanitizing board surfaces more often, they must wearing masks and other health protocol they must obey. Another area of concern is proper food labeling. As you can see, food labeling is defined as a description of food and in form of image, text, or combination of both or other forms that are including in food into attached to form part of food packaging. So it's very important in food labeling. Labeling provides necessary information for consumers such as expiry date, nutritional information, storage information, government identification permit, and production address that support its traceability. Online consumer can only inspect the label once when the food is arrived, unlike those who purchase from physical store. The Indonesian Consumer Foundation, or Indonesia we call it Yayasan Lembaga Konsumen Indonesia, or YLKI, received several consumer complaints regarding expired food purchased online. The second item is food delivery. You know that food delivery may be the most significant aspect in online food delivery that makes it different from traditional online food transaction. Of course, food safety during delivery depends on delivery percent that is determined by other side temperature, whether they are sweating, the weather, delivery time, proper food packaging and storage, are they hand clean enough or not. Concern about food safety in food delivery include incorporating handling, during which food is treated no differently than non-perishable product after leaving the merchant or restaurant. For example, a lack of cold chain, proper storage, can result development of pathogen like E. coli, which cause diarrhea, often bloody with accurate abdominal cramps for 3 to 7 days after consume the food. The WHO also recommend that cooked food not be left at the room temperature for more than 2 hours. In order to follow this guideline, the delivery person must immediately deliver the food, especially in the case of hot meals. In addition, they must pay extra attention to keeping food clean, especially from insect or pest during the delivery trip. So this is done by using extra packaging. Okay, let me come back to previous slide here. They are using extra packaging. As you can see, they are using a plastic bag. They are using special bags. They are using another kind of container. This is done by using extra packaging to protect the food, such as plastic, paper provided by the merchants. Part of environmental initiative to reduce plastic while ensuring the food safety, ride-hailing companies has been gradually giving out reusable insulated thermal bag like this for food to their driver partner, especially in big cities such as Jakarta, Bandung, Semarang, Surabaya, Denpasar. During the COVID-19 pandemic, food delivery produce include additional health protocol. The COVID virus can pick up from drivers who get infected and contaminated frequent touch surfaces such as steering wheels, maybe door handles, mobile devices, and other kind. So, food consumption online is not consumed immediately after preparation. So, it differs with direct buying to the physical merchant. After preparation at kiosk or restaurant, consumer must be ensured the safety of food after they are received. Food safety after delivery is ensured through proper hygiene, maintain the proper temperature, or reheating the food thoroughly more than 60-100 degrees Celsius prior to serving. Unfortunately, many consumers still have poor food safety awareness. Only 72% of consumers always clean the table, 73% wash their hand before consuming product, and they were ordered. In addition, many consumers fail to follow the storage and reheating instruction attached in the product. Another study shows that consumers who made online food purchases found that 54% on online food always read food label, while 41% only sometimes read the label. Consumer may not follow the food safety standard because low awareness, particularly awareness that importance of food hygiene, personal cleanliness, and hand washing. Here we can see that impact of crisis of consumer behavior due to COVID-19, see that immunity concern, growth in health food, job losses, essential food focus, stay at home, boom in online groceries, also online delivery service in food industry, stay at home, more cooking at home. It seemed that the online grocery here and supermarket still have a positive impact even in COVID pandemic. Top food consumer spend market, of course, China, India, Japan, Russia, Indonesia. Here's also consumer spend market due to COVID-19. From the explanation, we can conclude that Muslim tends to consider halal food purchases because of halal awareness. However, studies of halal awareness and online delivery have not been widely carried out, especially for the millennials who have characteristic of being disloyal of their brand. It is interesting in study halal awareness in a Muslim, especially in millennial, to combine it, finding out buying interested in online food delivery. So this signals post-COVID-19 as new normal, as new living style for global food industry. That's seen consumer related to healthy food, alternative protein, they find it out, online groceries, cook at home, customer trust, value chain related to manufacturing automation, advanced supply chain risk management, work from home, cloud kitchen, like things like Internet of Things, even food internet, logistic technology. But for government, they need to advance food security, measurable, traceable, enhance the regulations with third party of a partnership. Perhaps they have to add the social safety net and international coordination between Indonesia and other country, including the halal and the halal labeling and the knowledge of Indonesian people due to the halal product. So the halal and food safety recommendations, we have three recommendations: simply pre-market certification for the household industry, enable to co-regulation in the regulation framework for food safety, revising the single use of plastic pan for processed food delivery. Like here, this is the video. I will try to play it after I finish my presentation. This is from BPOM. That from BPOM is kind of a certification that assure that food safety in Indonesia. They already have a kind of transfer knowledge to people even in the city or in the rural area in Surabaya. This is from Surabaya BPOM. This is the dangerous and haram food materials that contain to the common in market, maybe in Indonesia as well, and maybe in other country as well, like the using of blood here. They are not the meat from cows, but other meat, but they are using the blood cows to fake the meat. that so they can sell it higher in the traditional market. The use of dangerous and chemical material like formalin and other material used in you know, to prolong the expiry date of meat or the other fresh material such as fish and so on. So we have two conclusions. The awareness of consuming halal is not only from Muslim but also non-Muslim, because they think it's safer to purchase halal food. That's the reason why the halal food industry is very attractive. Therefore, it is important to promote halal food as being safety compliant, since they undergo one of the safest methods of production. Likewise, more research work should be conducted to fill the gaps between the halal market development besides those of other mentioned countries before, like France, Brazil, UK, and other countries. High demand of halal food should provide benefit for consumers in terms of giving a safer product and obligatory for Muslims to consume the halal food. Implementation of food safety system has an important role in keeping food safe for consumer consumption. This must be realized by small, medium enterprises actors, because now consumers increasingly concerned about food safety, and food safety system in food supply chain must be considered in all aspects in the business processes, from sources like raw material, processes, transportation, distribution system. Every stage of the business process of food supply chain has different types of risk and impact of food safety. So that's all my presentation. Thank you for your attention, ladies and gentlemen. Hopefully this information can be useful. And in the end of my presentation today, I hope we can take good lessons from what I deliver. I ask forgiveness from any words and behave we have not supposed to. Thank you for your kind. I'm so sorry if there are any words or behave my unpleasing. And may God, I beg for forgiveness. We are waiting for your visit, ladies and gentlemen, in our campus in Surabaya, Universitas PGRI di Buana, Surabaya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good afternoon. I give you back to Seven.
Thank you so much, Doctor.
Seven, I would like to play the video. I ask my friends to play it.
Sure.
Okay. Please.
Meanwhile, may all participants fill in. May all participants fill in the feedback form which I sent in the chat box. Thank you.
Okay. Can you hear it, Seven? The sound.
Yes, loud and clear.
A loud and clear. Okay, thank you. This is Surabaya Seven, and Mr. Chen, you are presenting Sisu. So I present Surabaya City. This is my beautiful city, Surabaya. It's very clean, it's very large, second city larger in Indonesia. So you can come and step by here. We have a lot of culture, including food culture, dancing, acting. This is the central of Surabaya City, central of Tunjungan, and our river is very clear, as you can see here in the video. So you can come and just walk around the city. So Surabaya has a lot of high-rise building, like other big city in Indonesia. This is the Tunjungan. You see the Surabaya as hero of the hero city. This is the place that Tugu Pahlawan or the hero the central hero city in Surabaya. So as you can see that Surabaya has part of building and it's kind of a beautiful city right now. So this is Surabaya. Thank you Nicole or Seven. I just want to stop there and excuse me.
Thank you, Associate Professor Imnya, for the wonderful webinar. It was definitely an informative and knowledgeable sharing. And thank you all for the participations. We will go ahead and take some time for questions now. Just a reminder, you can still submit your questions through the chat box in your control panel. In the meantime, kindly scan the QR code on the slide or through the link I sent in the chat box to fill in the feedback form. We will only give the e-certificate for those students who fill in the feedback form. Thank you. We will wait for a while for any questions. So the e-certificate will be given out according to the name list that who fill in this feedback form. So we are waiting for some questions. If you have any questions to ask, regarding the topic Associate Professor Imnya mentioned just now, kindly send it through the chat box.
It seems that I have question to Mr. Chen. But where is Mr. Chen, Seven?
I'm not sure whether Mr. Chen is still in the meeting room or not. Yeah.
Okay.
maybe let me ask. Chen Jingchun 老师在吗？
哦，他还有其他的课，所以他先走了。
So Mr. Chen has other classes to going on, so he's not
okay
right now. Yeah.
Okay. Seven. It seems that I want to go to Suzhou, it's a very beautiful city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've been traveled to Suzhou when I was studying in Shanghai.
Yeah.
It's a good place. It's a very comfortable place to travel. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is it Muslim friendly also, Seven, in Suzhou? Do they have a label of halal food or you know, halal transport, halal tourism centers? So they have a kind of a system or certain mechanism in Suzhou so we can comfort the traveling there?
I'm not so familiar with Suzhou, but what I can tell in Shanghai is I have some friends from Pakistan, so they are also Muslim. Basically, in our canteen, in our campus canteen, they will have some halal food store.
Yeah.
We call it Xinjiang. You know Xinjiang?
Yeah,
because the Xinjiang people is also Muslim.
Okay.
Yeah, so their food is also halal.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the Pakistani friends, they will have their lunch or dinner in this Xinjiang restaurant.
Okay. Is it available also in Suzhou, right?
Yeah, I think there is available in Suzhou also because this Xinjiang restaurant is kind of familiar in everywhere in China because I have like traveled to several places. I can see some Xinjiang noodle shop, like noodle stall all around there, yeah.
Maybe you can stop by to Surabaya 7.
Sure. I always wish to travel to Indonesia.
Okay, we'll wait for you soon.
Yeah.
Maybe other students have questions, maybe. Here we have some students that's still available there.
If there is no questions, we can like easily end the Q&A sessions.
Okay. All right, Seven. Thank you very much.
If there's no questions, we'll end the Q&A session here. So thank you again, Associate Professor Imnya, for the knowledgeable webinar. Before we continue to the final part today, I would like to remind all of the participants to scan the QR code on the slide to fill in the feedback form So your feedback is very important for our improvement. Thank you. Yeah, so before ending, let us take another group photo together with our associate professor unit.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. All right, so may all participants turn on your camera. We'll take a photo in a count of three. 1, 2, 3. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Seven. Thank you, brothers from Suzhou. See you in Surabaya soon.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you so much. We will hope to see you again in the future. The webinar for today ends here. Thank you. 希望未来我们还有机会能再次合作。谢谢大家。Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Bye. 再见。
再见，老师。
Thank you. Bye.